Hi guys, I'm Dr. Zainab Vora and I teach radiology on an academy. So this is the series that we've started late in the night every day, 11:30 p.m. wherein we talk about a few must-know images, and the theme for today's class is going to be skull x-rays. So this is going to be a short 15-minute video wherein we look at some high-yield images on a daily basis till your exams, such that you have a grasp over the radiology images, which have become very, very important part of all entrances nowadays. Alright, so let's begin with skull x-rays. Before that, I'll quickly orient you to an academy. So download the app and check out the various free classes which go on every day in case you want unlimited access to all the educators, and you want to access the batch courses, you can take the plus subscription. And if you want to combine it with prep ladder, you can avail the iconic subscription, which is under a lot of offers right now. So definitely make use of the slashed prices. And these are also offers wherein you can extend your subscription on long-term packages. So starting tomorrow, we have various batches which are launching on INICT, clinical examinations, as well as next 22 and 23. In case you want to subscribe, definitely use my code, which is ZVORA Live or ZVORA, in order to get a further 10% off on your subscription. So let's begin with the various skull x-rays. These are very, very important, and usually you'll see at least one of them figuring in your exam. Okay, so this one image, lateral skull radiograph that we are seeing, is showing us multifocal lytic lesions. You know, there are so many lytic lesions that you can see of various sizes. So this has been described as punched out. It seems as if somebody has punched out these holes in the skull. So punched out lytic lesions, or some people also like to call it the raindrop skull appearance. Where do we see this? This can be seen with various lytic metastases, or this can be associated with multiple myeloma as well, which will also show you these lytic lesions throughout the body. Remember one feature to distinguish based on the skull radiograph itself: the mandible has been included. If there are lesions in the mandible, it favors a diagnosis of multiple myeloma over lytic metastasis. Alright, so this is about raindrop skull, punched out skull. On the other hand, if I see these very, very tiny, tiny lesions, tiny, tiny resorption of the bone of the inner table as well as outer table, this is described as the salt and pepper skull appearance. So this salt and pepper skull appearance, wherein you have these tiny black areas, tiny white areas, is something that you see with hyperparathyroidism. Alright, so this can be seen with primary as well as secondary hyper-PTH, wherein you have this bony resorption because of increased parathyroid hormone levels. Right, so this is because of bony resorption. This is the salt and pepper skull. Remember, these are much tinier and granular in appearance than the punched out skull. Okay, the next one here, the history of a child would be given, and you would see that there are now these larger geographic lytic lesions, and you see that they have a double margin, isn't it? They have a bevent margin, wherein you can see this differential destruction of the inner table and the outer table. So this is described as geographic lytic lesion, and this is something that is associated with Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Alright, so remember various names of LCH. So in case you have a multisystemic disorder, in which case you are seeing these multifocal bony lesions throughout the body, most commonly the pelvis can be affected, skull can be affected, spine can be affected. Alright, so multisystemic disease, we use the term letterer sieve disease. Alright, so that is what we call for a multisystemic LCH. If you are finding that only the skull is involved or only the vertebra is involved, means an isolated bony involvement is seen, that is referred to as eosinophilic granuloma. On the same lines, remember, if the spine is having this lytic lesion, it will usually present as this flattened out vertebra. While the other vertebral bodies would be normal, here you would have a flattened out vertebra that is called a vertebra plana. So single calvarial lesion or a single spinal lesion can be eosinophilic granuloma. On the other hand, if you have a triad of these skull lytic lesion plus diabetes insipidus plus you have exophthalmos, all right, plus you have exophthalmos in the child. This triad is called the Hand-Schuller-Christian triad. All right, so this is the Hand-Schuller-Christian triad. So same pathology, depending on the manifestation, can have these three different names. Okay, what is this? When you see that there is this gyriform sort of calcification on the lateral skull radiograph, this is called as the tram track appearance, which is seen with Sturge-Weber syndrome. So this is associated with Sturge-Weber syndrome. A CT counterpart shows the same, wherein you have complete ipsilateral gyral atrophy along with calcification. So you can see that this side of the brain, right side, is completely atrophic with calcified gyriform appearance, which is tram track. So this is Sturge-Weber, a triad of refractory seizures clinically because of this atrophy. Apart from that, you will have a port wine stain on the same side, ipsilateral port wine stain, typically in the V1 territory, trigeminal 1 ophthalmic territory, where you'll have a purplish port wine stain. Apart from that, you can also have congenital glaucoma. So this is the triad of Sturge-Weber. Remember, it is not inherited, it's a sporadic mutation which happens. Okay. Moving on to the other disease, an elderly patient would be described to you who's having this increased head size or has cranial nerve compression, typically optic nerve compression, or has hearing deficits because of auditory canal compression. So what is this pathology? So we are dealing with Paget's disease. Yeah, from the description you would have guessed, we're dealing with a Tom O'Shanter appearance. Paget's disease can have various phases. So if you see that there are these multifocal sclerotic spots, these are referred to as cotton wool skull. So this is the sclerotic phase, wherein you would see cotton wool skull appearance. In the lytic phase, we would see that there is this well-defined large lytic lesion that is called as osteoporosis circumscripta. Yeah, so that is described as osteoporosis circumscripta. So these are the various phases of Paget's disease, depending on which we could have white sclerotic foci or a lytic appearance or a mixed appearance. Most common bone involved in Paget's, remember, would be the pelvis. Apart from that, they can ask you complications of Paget's. So remember, secondary osteosarcoma plus, because of diffuse bony remodeling happening throughout the body, these patients are also prone to develop secondary high output cardiac failure. Okay, so this is about Paget's. What is this skull appearance, wherein we are seeing that the trabeculae are all raised? The trabeculations in the skull are all raised to give this very typical hair on end appearance or a crew cut appearance, a favorite of FMV examiners. This is seen in any hemolytic anemia. Alright, so this is associated with hemolytic anemia. It could be thalassemia, sickle cell anemia. So depending on your options, choose. But it is seen because of extramedullary hematopoiesis in cases of hemolytic anemias. Right? What about this? A child who's having raised intracranial pressure. Can you see this calvarial appearance, wherein we are seeing these convolutions of the brain on the skull? So this is because of raised intracranial pressure in children, resulting in these convoluted margins. This is referred to as a copper beaten or a silver beaten skull appearance. Alright, so remember, this is a marker of raised ICP. Apart from that, if they do ask you earliest markers of raised ICP on X-ray in a cases of a child, then your answer is going to be sutural diastasis. The sutures are going to open up and we will see the widening of the sutures. If they ask you in cases of adult, remember, the answer here would be erosion of the dorsum cella. So dorsum cella erosion is what will be seen in an adult patient. Okay, so this is about raised ICP. What about this skull appearance here? This is the anterior fontanelle. You can see that there is increased AP diameter of the skull. Plus, look at the cella. The cella is not normal like this. It is shaped like a J. So this is a J-shaped cella associated with various skeletal dysplasia. So a mnemonic to remember this is Conman. So these are various conditions wherein a J-shaped cella can be seen. Most importantly, it could be a normal variant as well. So typically, you need to remember mucopolysaccharidosis, something which is the most important thing, can also be seen in achondroplasia, osteogenesis imperfecta, or if there is a tumor which is growing from the optic chiasma, it can remodel the cella, So optic chiasmaglioma, which can be seen with NF1 or because of a chronic hydrocephalus. Most important takeaway from the mnemonic conman, remember mucopolysaccharidosis, G-shaped cella. And in this case, what do we see? We see that, first of all, before we look at the skull, the mandible, there is prognathism that you are seeing. There's increased size of the sinuses. Plus, you would observe that the calvarium itself is thickened, and I'm seeing that the cella is now enlarged. This is called as a ballooned out cella. So this ballooned out cellular appearance is associated with a pituitary adenoma, and we are seeing this prognathism, sinus increases, all connective tissue increasing in size. This is associated with acromegalia. So we likely have a GH producing adenoma leading to acromegaly. One specific feature that you want to look out for when dealing with acromegaly is increased heel pad thickness. So if ever you see an examiner asking you an image of the foot with increased heel pad thickness, always think of acromegaly. Alright, what about this? Slightly difficult, but if I give you that there's an infant who's presenting with a mass here, and on the x-ray we are having the sutural diastasis with this hair on end kind of appearance, widened suture, this is likely suggestive of metastasis, skeletal metastasis to the bone, leading to sutural metastasis, and these bony metastasis in an infant, always think of neuroblastoma. So neuroblastomas are prone to developing this sutural diastasis with this hair on end appearance. Alright, so these were the various skull images that we wanted to discuss. I hope this was useful. So a good compilation of all of these images and seeing them together will help you distinguish them in the exam. Okay, so all the best, and I'll see you all very soon with the next video. Thank you.